This is like being interviewed by Donald Rumsfeld and Abby Gray.
Women seem to like this movie.
Yeah.
A surprising amount. I mean, to me, it's somewhat a surprising amount because people are blowing up.
Yeah, I've recognized that too.
Yeah.
That women are liking the film. They're coming up to me afterward at screenings and just, you know, effusive with their enthusiasm.
What do you think it is that they're liking?
I think the honesty of it, and I think performances.
Is there a chick guy thing? I mean, is that, you obviously have broken that boundary more than probably any female director we know of. Not that you should be categorized in that little box, which I always hate, but
why not? Let's put her in the box and then take her out of the box.
Where is where is that box?
Here's the box.
The box is there. I mean, it's like everybody's obsessively, compulsively about the box.
You know, I would think that in the day and age of Hillary Clinton, the box shouldn't be there. That we could get to a point where it's not even a topic of conversation.
Because she's pretty much tougher than any guy.
But I know that we're not there yet, obviously.
But I mean,
we can get there.
Do you think there is a different? I mean, does everybody ultimately like a good movie or that hits emotionally?
Yeah, I think a good story, good characters, I think kind of crosses all lines.
So where did you guys start? It started with Mark's story in the, I guess, it was New York magazine.
It actually started with his embed. I knew he was going over there, and he would email me from in theater these incredibly harrowing experiences. And so, providing he survived, I knew that there'd be a great film there.
And he didn't survive, it would be bad.
That'd still be good, right?
And then I'd have to just cobble it together out of these emails. I don't know.
Right.
But how did you guys start the process of writing something, of actually putting a script on paper?
Threat of bodily harm.
And then
here's a pen. Here's a.
It's hard to get him to write. Is that what you're saying?
If you work for Paramount, disregard what you just said. That's not true at all. I write on time, very fast, very professional.
The nice thing about Paramount is they don't actually expect anything from any of the writers. They just pay them a lot.
Well, that would be cool.
Never make their movies, but that's cool. Another conversation.
No, I mean, the thing about it was that it was. First of all, I really didn't know what I was doing at all, and I had never really, I had worked with Paul Haggison in the Valley of Ella, so I had some experience with a screenplay, but that was like 6 months of experience, so I really didn't know what I was doing, except for what Paul had taught me, which is quite a lot, but still, I didn't know what I was doing. And second of all, it never occurred to me that it was actually going to become a movie, because it was something that we just did on spec, and I could afford to like kind of not work for a little while and work on the screenplay, and so it just seemed sort of as a pie in the sky like thing that then gradually became more and more real, and then, you know, cut to a year later you're standing in Jordan and it's actually happening. But it didn't start formally, I guess is what I'm trying to say. It was all very casual.
I knew it was going to happen. I was completely convinced from the beginning.
It's too inherent. You did.
And he would ask me constantly, "You think this will be a movie? You think this will be?" I said, "Yes." Yeah.
You know, whoops. That all just seemed.
Fall from a rock.
This is about as cash as it gets. it just seemed completely unlikely to me. That, I mean, it just seemed ridiculous.
So was the conversation about not making it a chatty movie or a movie? I mean, it clearly is built around a number of set pieces of, you know, six or seven events that take place, and you manage to get beyond the episodic. Clear, I mean, that's what's the great thing about the movie, I think. But at the same time, it's not the, you know, war is hell. Let's sit around talking about how terrible war is all the time. That's not the movie. The movie is men who go and do it. Was that a direction you gave him? Was that something Mark kind of brought to it with his story?
I think it's what he brought to it. I mean, he came back and it was the material that he was both, you know, articulating and also writing in the article was very repertorial, obviously, because that's the genesis of it. And so I felt like, okay, as a filmmaker, I want to keep it repertorial, keep it real, put the audience in a sort of, you are there, boots on the ground, fly on the wall, you know, keep it as visceral, raw, and immediate as possible, and not kind of, you know, aestheticize it in a way, and therefore, you know, let it live in its purity, and it should work, you know. So, I mean, don't you think that's sort of, I mean, that's how we talked about it.
That's well said. And I just, from a writing standpoint, wanted to recreate the experiences that, or fiction, you know, a fictionalized version of the experiences to just convey what it's like over there. And so what's the most effective way to do that is to do it repertorially and not sort of with a lot of hyper drama. I mean, it's still dramatic, but it's not stylized drama.
So
keep it naturalistic and realistic, and then those are the kind of movies I happen to like. So, you know, that's what I was drawn to.
And I kind of felt that it was so, I mean, you're looking at a day in the life of a bomb squad. These are men who have the most dangerous job in the world. Mm-hmm. So as a filmmaker, I kind of wanted to get out of the way of the material. You don't need to sort of trump it up. I mean, it's inherently dramatic. Right. So just, you know, this is dawn to dusk in the day of these, you know, these men's lives. And
it's also that they're real. I mean, I think we both felt a sense of responsibility to the fact that
it's an ongoing conflict.
Yeah, it's a real thing, and there are real people that actually are losing their lives over this stuff. And so you want to be in the attempt to be as faithful to what they go through. That starts to shape the storytelling a little bit as well, because you don't, some of the things that might feel inventive and cinematic on their own terms, they don't match up with the reality. Then it starts to feel like, well, why would we impose that kind of fake, you know, storytelling convention on something that is, that, you know, just because of the kind of timeliness of it, it felt like we had to be a little more, whatever, like, however she said it. I can't do this.
Well, when you drop into the scenes between the characters, I mean, there's a lot of men who don't talk, which is, I guess, normal for us as a species. But then you have the scenes that are as dramatic as anything happening on the, you know, the field of the bomb defusal. Diffusing.
Well, I think it's very artificial to, you know, put men in these, you know, really, truly catastrophic situations and suddenly have them go into long reveries of their own personal backstory when, you know, at any second, you know, their lives could be lost and they have to make constant split-second decisions under extreme pressure about, you know, how to disarm a particular bomb, or is that a sniper calling in your coordinate, or is a guy up on a balcony, you know, hanging out his laundry. So, you know, they're not really moments that allow themselves to, or allow the characters to suddenly relax and go into great reveries about their past. So, you know, I think, again, it's back to the necessity of a day in the life of a bomb tech. And, and also an opportunity to look at heroism. You know, really look at heroism. I mean, like, kind of real, true courage under fire. And I think that's finally the you know, that which the film, you know, the quality of the film that really endures is the opportunity to look at heroism and the cost and price of heroism. And I think that's why the material was so startling to me, where, you know, the opportunity to describe and to present those individuals.
But heroism is not always...
I feel like Silent Bob.
Though heroism is not always heroic. I mean, it's one of the things that's fascinating about the film is that Jeremy's character, you know, really why he's there and what motivates him and what he needs is not just purely, you know, I want to be a great person. He's not a saint by any stretch of the imagination.
Yeah, I mean, it was an attempt to maybe look at the psychological profile of the guy. You see the guy in the headlines on the front page of the paper that's saved the whatever, and he's a hero, and then kind of go beneath that a little bit and see what the psychological price men pay sometimes to do those really brave things. And so Jeremy's character is one of those people who on the surface seems to be really courageous, and he is, but there's a reason for that, and that's kind of what the movie looks at.
These guys also talk a lot with their fists. Is that normal for your experience embedded, or?
They talk a lot with their fists. Well, I don't know. I don't know if I would agree with that. I guess they there are certain points that can only be made
that are punctuated. No pun intended.
I mean, I guess I like dialogue that's naturalistic, and so that tends to, In my experience, limited as it is, people tend to be a little more laconic than in real life than they are in the movies, especially when they're in the military and they're getting shot at. I mean, you tend to just sort of say what's necessary in those moments. There's a lot of fighting in the army. I mean, fortunately or fortunately.
But. Do these guys go off book much and improvise as much during the sequences in their barracks, I guess?
Which, well, there's the fight scene?
The fight scene, heavy drinking and everything.
No, that wasn't really off book much in there. I mean, that was pretty scripted, actually. But actually, that was one of the moments they were actually, I expected them to be more improvisational than they were. I mean, there were some times when they were improvisational and I thought, why would you improvise now? This is like the most straightforward thing. But it tended to be like the more complicated the scene, the less they would improvise. And then the easier the scene, the more they would improvise, I found. Hmm. But I don't know. Maybe that's not. Maybe that was just.
But their instincts were always true to character and really spot on. But the dialogue was so naturalistic that you kind of can't, you know, tell when, you know, there might be a line or a word that's off book to book. I mean, it's very seamless.
You guys, Jeremy did invent that joke, though. I'll give him credit for the ring joke.
Right.
That was his joke that he came up with. The Eldridge character holds up a ring and says, "What about this one?" Because it's all the
you're
stuff
saying
in
all the
box.
Objects that
it's
could like, have killed me.
What about this one? And he goes, "Yeah, but whatever. Like I said, stuff that almost killed me."
Right.
Jeremy loved that joke, and he had come and he was like so proud of it. He was like, wow, it's like my wedding. My wife almost killed me. That was a Jeremy line.
You guys seem very much like a team through this whole process. Actually, from the time the movie opened in Toronto, it seemed pretty clear that you guys were, you know, doing a lot of interviews together, having a lot of things together. Is that your normal way of working with writers, or is that the circumstance of this particular piece?
Well, you know, I've always felt that the great, I don't know, one of the great aspirations, one of my great aspirations was to have a writer on set and have that luxury of looking at a look, because you never write a script to the exact locations that you find. There's always changes, or the actor's tailoring it perfectly to that particular actor at that moment, or the suddenly, you know, an idea will occur to you, but then making sure that it works within the entire context of the piece. Mm-hmm. So this was the first time I was able to enjoy that luxury. And so I just, you know, it's like, I'm just not gonna let go of it. I mean, I've always wanted to have a writer on set. I mean, I guess when I shot Near Dark and Blue Steel, I had myself, but, yeah. I mean, even though that was co-written with Eric Red and he was wonderful, but he was off doing something. So it's always been a great aspiration. Then first time was realized.
Is doing it small easier? I mean, you had a few...
More control. Lot more. Creative. We had total creative control. I had final cut, and I was determined to cast emerging talent and breakout actors. And so we were able to, you know, it was a trifecta, I guess.
Well, you've had the studio experience a few times, and it seems like you... kind of went back to...
No, they've all been independent. Nobody realizes that. Even K-19 was through...
It's a big independent.
Was a very... I know. I know. Well, let's say... I mean, it, by the definition of the word, it was true independent. However, it was a large independent. So, so I've actually, to be honest, had very little interference, but this was absolutely none. You know, it was... I mean, we went off the reservation. We shot in the Middle East, and no one could find us. No, we had
turn off the cell phone.
Right, we were there were no known coordinates for our location.
Kathryn's taking off her helmet again. Anything could happen. So when you
will you
this
please
stuff,
ask her to put her headset back on?
Turn the damn headset back on. And then Mark comes over and punches you in the face.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Everything's fine.
Is it completely comfortable with you running a show that's just boys? I mean, it's kind of amazing when you think about it. Were you the only woman on the set? Did you have a bunch of other, any other?
Well, no, there were women in the crew. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I had in the AD department, I had many, like, seconds who were mm-hmm. women. And many of whom we actually, we both created a kind of trainee program from the film school. So mm-hmm. we were able to... As much as this is in Jordan, yeah. As much as we were utilizing that country, we're hoping to give a little bit back. And so when we left there, it would then feel like an even more film-friendly environment. But
how film-friendly is it now?
Extremely. It's perfect. It's great.
Because are they giving? I
no,
guess,
no
incentives
one's,
in some way, or they?
They are now,
yeah, the minute we left, I think they instituted it.
And there is a film school that kids are going
yes,
through.
Yeah.
The Red Sea. Yeah. Red Sea Film Institute. Almost.
Yeah.
And they got some talent. I mean, is that really?
Yeah, there
places?
Was a Jordanian film that actually went now. What happened with
Captain
that?
Abu Ghraib?
Captain Abu Ghraib went to Sundance.
Yeah.
And it was nominated.
Yeah.
As an Academy Award
for the country.
Yeah. So I mean, you know, they're
enterprising.
They're working on it.
Yeah.
So when you take a look at the script and you know what's coming in, you kind of know what the scenes are. Are you just drooling over the possibilities of
working with men? No. What?
Of working with men. More about men. But no, the sequences of breaking down these, you know, these action sequences, because it's this amazing skill that you have, which you've shown over and over again, but you know, here
Thank
it's
you.
Particularly profound because there's so many of them kind of back to back to back, and each one of them is so different. So do you, you know, is that the second thing on your mind? Is that the third thing on your mind? Is it a...
Well, I have to say it really all, I mean, what excited me so much about this were the characters, but so it all kind of stems from that, but then it all comes from material. I mean, Mark's ability to put these set pieces together. And so it was a really rich canvas in which I think war is the ultimate canvas. And then on top of that, to have these incredibly, they're complicated, they're interesting, they're surprising set pieces that, I love breaking them down, doing the boards for them, and then ultimately, you know, scouting Morocco and realizing that Jordan was a much better location. And then he rewrote all of those set pieces for the locations that we found. And, you know, for instance, the scene with the cart bomb, you should talk about that. That, remember, that was all in one elevation. It was written for just a street and a cul-de-sac.
Yeah.
And then we found this incredible, it's like ex-UN building, actually,
right.
That was used.
It was
a schoolhouse
school, yeah.
Turned into a UN building. But it had all, they had a mosque, and it had all these different layers of opportunity. Come on.
That's true. So.
And so he just took advantage of it.
So we rewrote that sequence too. It's the same scene, but it just takes place, you know, three dimensionally instead of one dimensionally. Basically,
right.
I mean, it's like a rooftop and a street. So there's a lot of stuff like that too. We kept looking, I think, to make the action sequences as detailed as possible.
Yeah.
And even if the detail, I mean, what's great about Kathryn as a director is even if the detail is not inherently interesting, but it's authentic because it's part of what you actually do in the bomb squad,
mm-hmm.
she can shoot it in such a way that it becomes interesting. So, I mean, you'd write something like the guy sticks his hand in the rubble to look
right.
for a bomb, which on paper does not sound particularly thrilling. But then when she gets out there and shoots it, you're like, oh my God, that's the scariest thing in the world.
You're campaigning against your Oscar nomination.
He's sticking his hand in
the... It's like, keep that away from me. I don't want any awards. Give them all to Kathryn.
She should have them.
He's already won a writing award.
Absolutely.
I mean, there are many more to come, but anyway.
So is it, I mean, do you say, okay, I want more of a particular thing? Or do you just say, do you like having that kind of put a hand in rubble and then you figure out what that... how many shots that is, or?
Well, you have to add into the equation in that particular sequence, Jeremy Renner, who makes, I think, both of us look very, very good. So you have this incredible actor who's, you know, starting to take this 155 ordinance
mm-hmm.
and kind of caress it. And just so, you know, and all of a sudden, again, that's where, I don't know, it's somehow you've entered some, again, sort of a trifecta situation where you've got great material, great actor, terrific cinematographer,
so,
and it's
just committed to the,
yeah.
to the part. And so, I mean, I actually learned a lot about the bomb squad to write this script because I'd written an article, and so
right.
I'd done a lot of interviews and more than any human being should know about bombs, really. But Jeremy actually like went even farther, and
mm-hmm.
by the time he showed up in Jordan, he and I would have these insanely detailed conversations about debt cord.
Mm-hmm.
And like, you know, like it seemed really important at the time, like
mm-hmm.
that the debt cord be a certain way, because he and I both knew that it had to be that way to be right or whatever. But obviously, like in now looking back on it, it seems
mm-hmm.
why did we ever care about that kind of stuff?
Well,
but I think it gave him such a depth to his performance, right? You know, that kind of commitment and understanding of the
whole. Jeremy and Anthony work the same way as actors? Are they both methody? Are they both?
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, every single one is different.
They're
very different human beings. But you know, I think they really, well, first of all, their instincts are brilliant. They're incredibly talented, but and totally immersive. But immersive in their own way, you
mm-hmm.
know.
But Anthony is one of those guys who, like, in between takes, he's Anthony Mackie. I mean, he's his charming, outgoing. He's texting. He's talking to, you know, like, whatever cute girl might be within a 100-mile radius. Mm-hmm. And then the camera starts rolling, and he's Sanborn. And it's like, oh, my God. And mm-hmm. and Jeremy's a little more, you know, he's going to be,
he's Sergeant James.
Yeah, he seems more
from the moment he arrives on the set to the point when you wrap.
How did you end up with them in particular? Did you see other work, or did you just audition, or
both auditioned and saw work? I saw I was well aware of Jeremy through Dahmer, incredible performance, and I, looking from the moment I saw that film, for an opportunity to work with him, and then as he was talking to me about the characters in this film, I just kept thinking, wait a minute, where have I seen this guy? I've seen this guy. I know I've seen him. I realized Dahmer, and then Half Nelson. That's where I became aware of Anthony Mackie, and just thought he just was magnificent. And Jarhead, I thought Brian Garrity did a really pretty profound performance. So I just thought the three, that was kind of a perfect ensemble.
Was there any pressure to bring in a bigger name or anything like that, or is that the advantage of doing a smaller movie?
Well,
is there any pressure? The way that question should be phrased is, how did you withstand the titanic force of pressure? The soul-crushing pressure to bring a name. How did you possibly survive that? Now, there was a bit of interest in that, but Kathryn was very insistent, and she does not take no for an answer.
Yeah, I was she
cast
unwavering.
She wanted to cast, but yeah. Some of us were.
Well, was it just the actors in particular, or was it also the fact that they're relatively unknown, so therefore they slide into character more than for an audience? I mean, obviously.
Well, I think the minute you are faced with an actor of which you have very little knowledge of, there's very little baggage, then anything is possible. So I think that's exciting for this particular piece and those characters. But at the same time, ever since granted, it was my first film, but working with Willem, and then after that, Keanu, and after, you know, just either, if not, it really all came from actually seeing Henry Fonda in Once Upon a Time in the West and realizing how truly shocking it is to either cast against type or, in the case of Willem and Keanu, it was certainly maybe even Jamie Lee Curtis, just to kind of put somebody Angela Bassett, create prototypes, you know, as opposed to drawing on a lineage of stereotypes that we've seen before. It just, all of a sudden, it just, I don't know, becomes very, very exciting.
You also talked a lot about, just reminding you about the relative anonymity of the soldier to the audience, and keeping them feeling really realistic as soldiers and not as movie stars. And all that.
Right. We
and I would be like, what's the problem with them? You know, so they think he's a movie star. You know, big deal. It'll be fine. But she was right about that, because it really does lend a lot of, you know.
Yeah, I think it lends
a lot of credibility to every. It,
I think it's really, really important. I mean, we were scouting in Kuwait, at the military base in Camp Buring. At one point, we were thinking of shooting there. We ended up shooting everything in Jordan. But we were eating in a mess hall that was probably filled with, I don't know, 3,000 soldiers in digitals and their M4s. And I remember thinking that you just, if literally you put a blindfold on and picked three people from this room, there's your cast. In other words, it just, they had to feel so real. It had to feel real. The story was real. The reporting was real. I wanted Barry Aykroyd's cinematography to be real. The casting had to be real. You couldn't fight that. I mean, it needed to be repertorial. You couldn't deviate from that. That's what I mean.
Well, the funny thing, I think, for the producer side is that if the movie is not as good as this, then it becomes a real problem that you don't have, you know, a saleable name, quote unquote, in it. And if the movie is as good as this, it's great that you don't have a saleable name, because you create one. Essentially, I mean, I think that's when you think back.
Perfectly
to the
said.
You love.
Perfect. Why is the camera not on you? Say that. We need that soundbite.
It'll be there.
All right.
You just won't have my face saying it, which is probably better for everybody. But that's the thing. I mean, ultimately, it's a tap dance that way.
Yeah. Yeah. perfectly put.
Did you, are you still shocked by how Point Break continues to have the cultural resonance that it has? It's amazing how people are still obsessed with that movie all these years later.
Well, yeah, in fact, we just did a retrospective over at the Cinematheque and I introduced the film. I don't know if you were there, but it was pretty interesting that it still seems to have not only some resonance, but there's that theater production, that mm-hmm. Point Break Live, and in fact, there's a woman who plays me that was in the audience. Anyway, it's very funny. I won't go into that. But yeah, it's surprising and
it's an incredibly entertaining
and gratifying
movie.
I mean, you know,
it's a very, very well built, entertaining piece of work. Don't you think?
Do you look back?
I hope so.
It doesn't surprise me that it's. I mean, if you look at it, you think, yeah, okay, that's why people like it.
Well, I think it got. I mean, I don't. I can't say that I know exactly what the reviews were, but I remember there were. You know, people made fun of Keanu saying "whoa" or whatever, and somehow that's like evolved into being something people love more than, you know, they remember it and quote it like it's important to them, much like The Goonies, which is another like huge cultural point of reference from that period of time. People grew up with HBO watching those things over and over again mm-hmm. and love them to death. Do you look back much? Is that something you do?
Never.
Really?
Yeah, I don't. It's I just kind of keep looking ahead. Yeah.
You don't like it or just not interesting? Or?
I don't know. I just want to focus on the next project. You know, that's sort of my, I don't know. I don't know why. I mean,
I don't know why.
Do you watch your movies at this retrospective or do you watch, have you ever watched, gone back?
No, I'll just want to change it. I'll just want to recut it. I'll remix it, rescore it, everything. But not recast. Anyway, no.
When it pops up on HBO or Cinemax or whatever, do you
No,
watch,
she's terrible.
Or do you just terrible thing?
No, she never watches any of them. I can answer that. I tried to watch it with her. She won't do it. Or if she does watch it, it's the most irritating movie experience you've ever had because it's a non-stop barrage of, oh my God, that and that and that. And this and that. And just like, I actually thought this was kind of fun. Can you please be quiet? No. It's just talking over the whole thing. So.
Do you watch this anymore? Did you stop watching this back in the summer? Or?
No. I actually... Yeah, I'm really proud of this film. I think it kind of it came together quite nicely in a way that, you know, one can always hope and anticipate, but you know, we're quite fortunate, I think, on this one.
And now you're in the fun of selling the film.
Yeah, not my métier.
How about you, Mark? Are you becoming a media whore?
He's great at it. He's great.
That's better for
He's
you
great.
To answer than for me.
Well, but are you enjoying it? Do you find
media
it
whore.
Invasive? Or?
I think it's...
Come on, tell the truth.
I think it's a great way to... No, I actually do enjoy it. I mean, it's. I find it strange being on the other side of the... I much prefer being on your side of the interview mm-hmm. table. But it's been fun so far, and it's been very gratifying that the response that we've had is honestly, it's been very gratifying and hugely satisfying. So I'm enjoying it so far.
What's the stupidest question you've gotten so far?
There actually haven't been that many. I mean, people seem to really try to come at you with like something that feels interesting. So I don't know that there's been a standout clunker so far, but I'm sure there's still time.
And is there a moment when you feel like you've finished giving birth to the baby? Do you feel like you've now, or is this process or the opening, or was it just when the film was finished and you
when
were
is it finally cathartic and you can
you?
Kind of
yeah
it's not yet.
Really?
No, not I feel like I can't, you know, I mean, we can't really, it still has to enter the marketplace and that you kind of have to, as a filmmaker, sort of shepherd it through that, you know, through that process. And, you know, it's still, it's beginning to have a life of its own, but not yet, soon. Mm-hmm.